ESPN, presented by Geico. The fourth-ranked team in the country visits Bryan College Station to face number 21 Texas A&M. As we welcome you to the SEC on ESPN, about 30,000 fans expected today at Kyle Field, along with several other Kyles in attendance. Two in particular, which will have a major impact on today's game. Florida quarterback Kyle Trask, who is from Texas, about 2 hours from here, and named after the stadium. 10 touchdown passes in his first two games this year. Six of them pulled in by tight end Kyle Pitts. Arguably the best tight end in college football, perhaps the best pass catcher, period. Can the Aggies unplug that connection and post what would be one of the biggest wins in years? And hi, everybody. Dave Pasch alongside Greg McElroy. We'll check in with Holly Rowe here in a little bit. And when you talk about, Greg, the best duos in college football, this one is right at the top.
Well, it's because Kyle Trask has been incredibly poised, so accurate, so confident, so comfortable in the system, and he has found a tight end. A tight end is a quarterback's best friend. And he has been an absolute matchup nightmare, Kyle Pitts has. And with what they've done offensively, spent most of the time last year at the wide receiver position, split out wide. Now they're moving him in line, and he's getting matched up with more linebackers and safeties. So he has been absolutely unstoppable here in the early part of the season. And the Texas A&M defense is going to have their hands full containing Kyle Pitts and trying to hold Kyle Trask in moderate productivity. He's been excellent this year.
And on the other side, you've got Kellen Mond, basically a four-year starter at quarterback for Texas A&M, looking for a signature win. He's had some gaudy stats, but can he beat a top five team? A&M won the toss and deferred, so Florida will get the ball first. Will be a touchback. It will come out to the 25. Let's bring in now the third member of our crew. Go down to the field. Say hi to Holly Rowe.
Well, Kyle Trask is the Florida quarterback, but his parents were students here at Texas A&M. Michael and Michelle met while they were here, and after they had their little boy, they decided to name him after Kyle Field. This is the building that Kyle Trask is named after. He said he's so excited to play here for the first time. He has been in this building before. He came here and watched Johnny Manziel play in a spring game, but he said he's very excited, not nervous. He's got about 30 friends and family here, and he said, I just want to play well for them. Let's see if he makes a name for himself here at the building he's named after.
And Manville, Texas, just south of Houston. Here's a flea flicker on the first play, and wide open out in space for a first down past the 40-yard line is Trevon Grimes. Little trickery to start today's game.
Yeah, try to take a shot over the top. Little flea flicker action. And this is what Kyle Trask done a great job of all year. Hey, man, it's not open downfield. No problem. Check it down. Get it out to your talented wide receiver in space and continue to get us moving forward. Kyle Trask has been very smart with the football in the early going and has this offense rolling.
17 yards on the first play. Trask to the air again. And it's pulled in. Kyle Pitts with his 13th catch of the season, gain of about 7 on the play.
They're going to try to move Kyle Pitts all over the field. He'll line up in line in a traditional tight end alignment. He'll line up in stack alignment in bunches like he is right here. He'll line out as wide receiver, just trying to find a favorable matchup in the offense.
Here's Pierce breaking a tackle, trying to get to the perimeter. Runs over a defender as he picks up the first down. Wow, he absolutely trucked Miles Jones and picked up the first down. Pierce isn't a huge guy, about 210 pounds, but they say he runs hard and is very physical.
And Pitts trying to clean it up there at the end, and you see Pierce, this running back room, I mean, they'll play a few different guys, really feel great about what both Malik Davis and Damian Pierce can do while carrying the football for the Gators offense.
Both are juniors. Davis from Tampa, Pierce from Georgia. Play action here for Trask. With time, and the pass is incomplete. He was going for Kadarius Toney. Good defense by Devin Morris. This is a prolific Florida offense through the first two games, 89 points. That's fourth in the country. They're number 2 in yards per play and put up over 640 yards against Ole Miss. School record against an SEC team.
Toney
22-year-old fifth-year senior quarterback. Kyle Trask working on second and 10 at the A&M 46-yard line. Pierce looking for running room, reverses field, and gets positive yardage to the 42.
You can see our sky cam has a little visitor there, Dave. What is it with bugs landing on stuff this week? It's been a huge story all over the place. Sets up a big third down here for Florida's offense.
Attendance to people limited. To insects, have at it.
For Florida here, too, I mean, this could be four down territory, just given how much they trust their quarterback and their offensive personnel. So might have two downs to get it here early in this game.
Play clock down to two. Got to snap it here. And Dan Mullen calls a timeout to avoid a delay of game penalty. Mullen in his third year has done a tremendous job so far with the Gators. His offense facing a third down when we come back. Number four, Florida at 2-0 on the season with wins over Ole Miss and South Carolina, facing 1-1 Texas A&M. The Aggies struggled against Vanderbilt but managed to win week one. Got pounded by Alabama last week. Looking to bounce back today. Florida faced with a third down and six at the A&M 42. Preseason first team All-SEC quarterback Kyle Trask, the first at Florida since Tim Tebow back in 09. Looking to make something happen here on third down. Trask sees some running room and takes off. And Trask is upended near the line to gain. It appears he'll be just short. We'll see if they go on fourth down.
I bet they will, too. That was a good job by Trask. Nothing open on play action. Probably thinking four down territory, and that's exactly what they'll have here.
And Davis in it, running back. And he'll get the call, makes a nice move, and picks up the first down. That was a great cut in space at the point of attack. And he moves it all the way down to the Texas A&M 29.
That was a great cut. If you see number two, Michael Clemens slip inside, almost makes the play in the backfield. But Davis, very patient runner, excellent job there, feeling the right side of the offensive line collapse, bouncing it to the outside for the conversion. Excellent, patient run there by the veteran back.
7 yards on fourth and one. So a fresh set of downs at the Aggie 30-yard line. They go back to Davis. Driving the legs, able to spin away from a defender, down to the 25. So a 5-yard run there for Davis, brought down by Leon O'Neill Jr., safety from Cypress, Texas.
It's so funny, if you ask Dan Mullen forever, he would tell you, look, we're a run offense, we're a power run offense. That's who we are, dating back to Florida with Tebow, and then, of course, at Mississippi State with so many great offenses. But here the last couple years, since Kyle Trask has been under center, they have really transitioned to more of a passing attack, and it's really suited their skill.
Trask throwing it out to Tony in the flat, and Tony is inside the 15-yard line. A flag comes soaring in. So while we wait for that, Greg, is that because Trask doesn't fit the mold of what you normally see at quarterback for a Dan Mullen coach team? I mean, you think about Dak Prescott, more of a running quarterback who obviously has become a great passer, but Trask is a passer first, right?
Without question. And the offensive line, too, much more comfortable in pass protection than they are in run blocking.
Tony, offense, number 15. 10-yard penalty from the start of the foul. We'll play second down.
But it's a testament to Dan Mullen's ability to adopt his philosophy to his personnel. And I think that is something that great coaches are always able to do. What do my guys do well? What are they most comfortable doing? You know, he has excellent tight end. He has excellent wide receivers. And his offensive line has struggled in the run game. His quarterback's also not real fleet of foot. So let's adopt the scheme to what our guys do well. And the results have been spectacular.
So second and 14. That big play erased. Trask to the air again. Has all day, takes a shot into double coverage in the end zone. It's broken up and incomplete. He went for Grimes, but there were two Aggie defenders. Damani Richardson had a chance maybe to pick that off. And it's third down at 14.
And a little greedy there. You're going to see deep play right here, and the safety stays over the top. He has Kadarius Toney working over the middle of the field. I think he might have gotten a little greedy there. You see Kadarius Toney, if he hits that right out of the break, he's probably got a big play. Instead, he locks in on the deepest throw and almost throws an interception. Very fortunate that wasn't picked off for Kyle Trask.
Already the 11th play of Florida's opening drive of the day. Trask hits Pitts. That pass a little behind him. You see the incredible hands of Kyle Pitts making the catch and moving the chains. Tackled at the 18-yard line. A gain of 16.
That's really good right there. Kyle Pitts working on a slant. They get motion out of the backfield, working to the left, which forces an underneath defender to run with that motion left, allowing for the slant to the right-hand side to find a one-on-one. And on a third and long, Kyle Pitts on a catch and run for the conversion. Just guy's unstoppable, man. He really is.
Here's Pierce getting the carry and drags a defender with him down to the 11. When you think about Kyle Pitts, and then you look at the guys that are excelling at his position in the National Football League, and the guys that got the big contracts, like Travis Kelce and George Kittle, he seems exactly like those guys.
Yeah.
He flex him out, he can do anything.
He's a lot like Travis Kelce, and for those that watch the SEC, he's a lot like Evan Engram. Except Evan Engram was 6'3", first-round pick of the New York Giants at Ole Miss, remember a few years back. Kyle Pitts 6'6", so he's got additional length and equal versatility and speed.
Not afraid to block, too, as they run Pierce left, and he's taken down in the backfield for a loss on the play. That was DeMarvin Leal, a starter a year ago as a true freshman, who made the hit. It's third down.
Aggie defensive line is a really talented group. So Florida have their hands full. A couple of young guys up there too for the Aggies that can get home, like McKinley Jackson, and they are very excited about some of their freshmen and the young guys that they're going to have contributing on defense.
6 minutes gone by in this drive. Play 14. Trask gets rid of it. It's caught. Going to be close. Boy, it looks like a nice spot for Tony. Enough to move the chains. It'll be first down and goal. Must have stretched that ball out as he was getting dragged down to pick up the first down.
Yeah, it looked really close. You'll see with Texas A&M, they do run a lot of man coverage, and against man coverage, getting speed guys in space and running them across the field to create separation is going to be a matchup that Florida tries to take advantage of. It's a good job by Tony being aware of where the sticks were to make sure he had enough for the first down.
Empty set here. Trask from the pocket. Goes to the end zone. Pitts, what a catch, but out of bounds. It's the fact he got his hands on that ball, but he couldn't get a foot down. Second and goal.
Just ran out of space there on the short side of the field. If you look, most teams, really the last couple weeks, they've said, wait, we're going to double-team Kyle Pitts. In the red zone, we're taking two guys, and we're covering 84. He will not catch passes based on how we align. Problem is, no one's been successful with it. Ole Miss got exploited on double team several times. South Carolina struggled last week as well. Hard to double a guy with how accurate Kyle Trask has been throwing it up and allowing Pitts to make plays on it.
A design quarterback run here, and Trask is pushed back at the 5-yard line. Four Aggies in on that hit, and so it'll be third down and goal now. 7-minute drive here. We talked about the guys making major money in the NFL at the tight end position. George Kittle, 15 mil. Travis Kelce, 14. It is now in vogue to want to be a tight end in the NFL. And a lot of these guys tried to move to receiver at the next level.
Yeah.
So third and goal. Trask. End zone shot. And Pitts got it. Touchdown. Two defenders right there. And Pitts able to rip it out of the air for the score. Seventh touchdown that leads all college football players. On that drive alone, three grabs, 28 yards. That drive took half the opening quarter. And the extra point by McPherson makes it 7-0 Gators.
Well, the Kyle connection clearly working in the state of Texas as Kyle Pitts finds one-on-one, goes up, makes an excellent catch. He's going to make a lot of money here very soon. Touchdown, Gators.
In spirit of Texas A&M and the dedication of those involved in the tragic collapse of the 1999 bonfire. Dave Pashbrake, McElroy, and Holly Rowe here in Bryan College Station, Texas. Kyle Field, where Kyle Trask, who dreamed of playing in this stadium growing up about 2 hours south of here, named after this building by his folks, who are Aggies themselves. Going to be a touchback. We'll come out to the 25 for A&M. Let's check in now with Laura Rutledge in the studio.
Dave, Rocket Mortgage studio update for you. We get you to Mississippi State against, excuse me, Missouri against LSU on the SEC Network alternate channel. Flea flicker from Connor Basilak. Eli Drinkwitz dialing it up there. That's actually the longest pass of Basilak's career. You got to be tricky against that LSU secondary, but LSU would answer here. Miles Brennan to Terrace Marshall back in the end zone there. They ended up reviewing it, said it was good. So that game tied on the SEC Network alternate channel, guys.
All right, Laura, obviously that game got moved because of the hurricane to Columbia. A&M on offense for the first down after Florida took up half the quarter on its opening possession. Isaiah Spiller for 2 yards.
Yeah, that's a great first drive from Florida. And now Kellen Mond, a guy that's played a ton of football over the course of his career, trying to have that statement performance against a top caliber team. He's been close so many times. Just hasn't been able to put a full, complete performance together against the top-tier teams in college football. So hoping for that opportunity here as a senior.
Had some turnover issues this year, an interception, two lost fumbles against Vanderbilt. Mond making his 37th career start today. He'll throw it here on second down, and the pass is knocked away. Elam with the good defensive play that time on Caleb Chapman. It will be third down and long.
And part of the issue with Kellen Mond is the efficiency. And if you look at his career record and the passing yards, of course, the productivity are remarkable, but he has to be more efficient. He has to be. Right now he's completing sub 60%, and the yards per attempt isn't where it needs to be, but it's the big plays, Dave. It's the big plays that he's left on the field on far too many occasions, hoping to connect on some of those today with the young receiving corps.
That's what Jimbo told us this week. And we got to have some of those. If we're going to beat a team like Florida, we got to have big plays. Kellen has to be more sharp. He's facing pressure here and delivers a strike. They've got a pretty good tight end as well. Jalen Weidermeyer. That's his 11th catch of the season. And he moves the chains on a 12-yard pickup.
And this is awesome, too. Great rush on the right side. You look at Brenton Cox for Florida. But that's a great anticipation from Kellen Mond. The rush is coming in. He knows he's going to get hit. It's a third and long, and he knows he has man coverage with this big tight end. So it's a great favorable matchup that A&M will try to exploit all day today. It's a good job of hanging in there by Kellen Mond and throwing accurately for the first down.
Out of the pistol here on first down at the 39-yard line. Play fake for Mond. And taking a shot here inside the 20. It's caught. They get one of those big plays. Caleb Chapman with single coverage pulls it in for 48 yards. They've been waiting for that all year from Mond, and he finally delivers.
Look at the safeties here who are just going to run, which allows the post over the top. Look how hard these safeties collapse on the play action fake, which gives you one-on-one on the outside to Chapman, and a beautiful throw. We talked about the big plays from Kellen Mond. First opportunity today, and he delivers. Excellent throw from the senior quarterback.
From the Florida 12. And a broken play there. Mond turned left. The running back, Spiller, went right. And it's a loss of 2 on the play for Mond. Let's check in with Holly.
Well, guys, something you'll see today for Texas A&M is number 0, Anaya Smith. He moved to running back, but you're going to see him back be a wide receiver today. His position coach, Tommy Robinson, told me he's the smartest young man I've coached in 34 years. He will play all 4 wide receiver positions today and running back. I'm not sure if I've ever seen that in a game. Let's see if they can get creative with how they get him the ball when he takes the field again.
Yeah, he's fun to watch, Holly, and he has done such a great job. You referenced this, the intelligence. You know how hard it is to learn 5 different positions at once? It's a testament to that young man's acumen.
Here, design run for Mond on 2nd and 12, and he gets absolutely walloped. What a huge hit by Amari Burney. You know, and Holly mentioned Tommy Robinson. That guy's been around. He mentioned over 30 years of coaching, coach running backs in the NFL, coach running back at Clyde Edwards-Helaire at LSU last year. So a pretty good judge of talent. Everybody's high on Anaya Smith. We'll see how involved he gets in the game plan today and perhaps here on third down and nine.
Yeah, he'll be a household name sooner than later. It looks like right here he's going to line up in the backfield. And this is going to be a really interesting look. You see right there Weidermeyer, the tight end who's flexed left. And then you have Smith at running back. That's the two best pass catching options at this point on the same side of the field. So I would imagine Mon's eyes start there.
Mon zips a pass to the end zone for the touchdown. Chase Lane was wide open. What a response by Mon to the Aggies.
This is a great job by Kellen Mon. Eyes right down the middle of the field, and he sees what you have, a kind of a two safety look. You see the Red Sea spread there in the back of the end zone. You have that in-breaking route to work the soft spot in the zone. Just a beautiful throw, similar to what they had last week to Reddick.
Extra point is good. Again, Jimbo Fisher said, we've got to have big plays from Kellen Mon today. And on the opening drive, the bomb, and then on third down and nine, the touchdown pass to Lane to tie the game. Here in Bryan College Station, in front of about 30,000 fans at Kyle Field. This is College Football on ESPN, presented by Geico, as we continue Dr. Pepper's Championship Drive Game of the Week with Greg McElroy and Holly Rowe, Dave Pasch. Jimbo Fisher, as he enters year three, 9 wins 2 years ago, 8 last year, but this would be, if they can somehow get it, their biggest win of the Fisher era, which is still in its infancy. Let's check in with Laura Rutledge.
Dave, North Carolina dominating Virginia Tech over on ABC. Sam Howell, a 37-yard touchdown pass here. That's pretty to Deami Brown. Virginia Tech dealing with some injuries. So far, it's been all North Carolina guys.
All right, Laura, here at 7-7, 4-minute mark. Touchdown pass by Trask, and then Mond with one of his own. Trask, 6 of 9, 51 yards, 3 catches from Pitts, including the touchdown. Trask pumps, gets hit as he throws downfield for Tony. What a catch by Tony, but ruled out of bounds, stepped out. Let's go back to Jimbo Fisher. There's a penalty marker down, but Fisher, a lot of Aggie fans.
Personal foul, roughing the passer, number 5 defense. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Mistake there with the late hit by Bobby Brown, one of the leaders of that defense.
And he just slams Trask to the ground. No, I mean, I understand we are protecting quarterbacks. To me, that was maybe a little bit aggressive at the end, but to warrant a 15-yard penalty, I'm not sure I'm on board with that one right there.
That puts the ball on the Florida 40-yard line. Play fake, Trask. Long throw hitting Grimes, able to break a tackle. And finally brought down at the 47-yard line, chased down by Michael Clements. So some Aggie fans are nervous, but a lot of young players on this Texas A&M team in year three for Jimbo.
I think a lot of people, because of the salary, people's eyes get wide and they expect them to win 10 games right out the gate. And that's just not reality. And granted, yes, the record against top-tier competition has been disappointing, but we have to remember the rebuilding and the foundation of this program is still in its infancy, especially knowing the challenges that COVID presented this team this year.
Trask, and wide open out of the backfield is Davis inside the 35-yard line. And he runs over a defender, still going. We've seen two Florida running backs take out Texas A&M defensive backs, and that's a 39-yard catch and run by Davis, who's a very good receiver out of the backfield.
Davis is an excellent receiving threat to go along with Damian Pierce, and just how excellent he is as well. Amazing to watch these guys complement each other and do so many special things.
Trask rolling out here on first down. Throws back to the end zone for Pitts, who adjusts, but it's incomplete. Boy, that is a long throw. and it was short, trying to hit Kyle Pitts, who had a linebacker, Buddy Johnson, on him.
He just tried to do a Mahomes throw, but just throw it to the running back in the flat. I know it's designed to be a throwback, but look at how wide open Malik Davis is. No one's within 15 yards of Malik Davis. He probably scores. He just throw a little five-yard completion instead. He tries to work the throwback, and if it's there, take it.
There are throwbacks, and then there are the throwbacks. I don't know that I've ever seen one that long. Trask hands it off. Davis plows forward to about the 16-yard line, so a pickup of four on the play, third down.
It's a big down here for the Aggie defense. They messed up the coverage last time, leaving Kyle Pitts in one-on-one. They cannot do that. Kyle Pitts, of course, is going to win that one-on-one matchup 99% of the time. Getting off the field, you haven't done a whole lot defensively to feel good about so far. Getting off the field here and forcing the Gators to only a field goal would be enormous, but they better have an answer for big number 84, who appears like he's going to be lined up at the top of the screen. And hopefully for Aggie fans, he won't be single covered.
Here's the quarterback, Trask, backing up and throws for an open receiver, caught. Kadarius Toney with a touchdown, and then a late flag is thrown. Trask getting into it with an A&M defender. But how about Dan Mullen's confidence in the arm of Kyle Trask? We saw it on the throwback, and then he kept backing up like Aaron Rodgers, 10, 15 steps, waiting for Toney to come free, and he found him for a second touchdown pass and 12th of this young season.
And they brought pressure off the right-hand side. There was an unblocked blitzing Aggie on the right side.
After the play, personal foul, defense, number 9, unnecessary roughness. Late hit out of bounds. That 15-yard penalty will be assessed on the kickoff.
That's Leon O'Neal. So you had two 15-yard penalties on A&M on that drive, one post-touchdown, but still.
Yeah, frustration there, obviously, there at the end of that one. But a great job by Kyle Trask buying time and taking advantage of Texas A&M, who is trying to take away Kyle Pitts with double coverage, work Kadarius Toney over the field. Excellent throw and catch.
...14-7, Florida. Two touchdown passes by Trask, one to Pitts, and now to Toney, his third of the year. Tonight on ABC, how good is Miami? Well, we're going to find out. Can they win at Clemson, the number one team in the country? De'Ara King, Trevor Lawrence, two outstanding quarterbacks. Lawrence may be the best in all of college football. They will clash tonight on ABC. Mentioned De'Ara King. He was the starting quarterback at Manville when Kyle Trask was there. Trask was the backup 6 years ago. They worked out together in the offseason. King started out at Houston and now at Miami. Trask was not highly recruited at all. Check in with Holly for more.
Well, the only way that Kyle Trask ended up at Florida was a coach was there watching one of his teammates, safety Deontay Anderson. He said, I only got an offer. My first was from Houston Baptist, then McNeese State and Lamar. And finally, somebody said that they saw me when they were watching Deontay. They told Doug Nussmeier of Florida and said, this kid's pretty good. You should look at him. He said, the day they offered me, I committed because it was my only Power 5 big-time offer. He's waited his turn, and he's ready for his moment here for the Florida Gators.
That's so funny. I'll tell you a little bit about that recruiting story here in just a second.
Squib kick. Chase Lane scoops it up, but in trouble inside his 10, and down he goes at the 6-yard line. Let's head to the studio, get a quick update from Laura. Four games into the season.
Pretty wild. Pretty wild when you think about what's going on in the Big 12 right now. And then Oklahoma State. Don't forget about Oklahoma State. Everyone just seems to forget that the Cowboys are playing good defense and are undefeated.
So Texas A&M backed up on its own 6-yard line. Bond throwing it out in space, out to about the 10 for a gain of 5 on the play for Smith.
Back to Kyle Trask and just how funny his recruitment was. I was talking with Jim McElwain right when Kyle Trask arrived on campus. He arrived on campus with Felipe Franks, who was a highly regarded prospect. And I was talking with Jim McElwain. He said, I don't know what is it that people didn't see in this guy? He's unbelievable. Have you seen this guy throw it? I've had to be talked into him by Doug Nussmeier, the offensive coordinator at the time. because the guy didn't have any high school tape, but I'm telling you, you watch him throw it, he's unbelievable. So McElwain found a gem, and Dan Mullen's done an amazing job of developing him these last couple years.
On second and five, Mond from the pocket. And wow, that was a really good throw in traffic. There's a guy that Holly talked about, Nia Smith, who went over 100 receiving yards last week against Alabama, picking up the first down.
This Texas A&M offense, so many opportunities last week against Alabama left on the field. It's almost as if they're about one block away or one half a block away from a big run, or maybe just the slightest bit inaccurate on a downfield throw, drop pass on a fourth and two. They had chances. They couldn't take advantage of them. But so far today, they look in rhythm. They look confident. And it seems like they have a really good plan to take advantage of a Florida defense that is not as good as they usually are.
Final seconds here, the opening quarter. And Mond has another completion. Caleb Chapman, who had that 49-yard catch, the longest play on offense for A&M this year through the air. He's out to the 23-yard line. And that will do it for the first quarter. Some fireworks in the opening frame here in Bryan College Station. Mainly by that duo, Kyle Trask and Kyle Pitts, hooking up three times here at Kyle Field, including a touchdown. Trask had another touchdown pass to Kadarius Toney. The fourth-ranked Gators look at a key national title hopes alive, leading on the road after one. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. From Kyle Field at Texas A&M, the Florida Gators leading 14-7. Former Gator and the NFL's all-time leading rusher, Emmitt Smith, in attendance here.
I'll be back in a couple plays. I'm going to go get an autograph real quick. As a Cowboy fan, I'll show a little love to Emmitt.
Well, I was going to say Arizona Cardinal legend Emmitt Smith. Fumble on the play as Spiller coughs it up. Texas A&M able to recover. You know, they do the thing on Twitter where, like, they throw out a player that played, you know, one season somewhere, but 15 years elsewhere.
I'm aware.
Just trying to gas you up as a Cowboy fan.
You know what? And honestly, I'm just not going to talk to you the rest of the time. I'm going to direct all my conversation towards Holly. So Holly and I will talk to each other while you kind of sit in your own little Arizona Cardinal bubble.
Go ahead. FaceTime with Tessitore over there. Go ahead. Joe will be back soon, Greg. Third down and two for A&M. It's 26-yard line. Mond throws another strike. First down catch by Weidermeyer. We've talked a ton about Pitts, but don't sleep on this guy in terms of the top tight ends in the country.
I love watching Weidermeyer. I think he is going to blossom into an excellent, well-rounded tight end. He's almost 270 pounds, but he moves so smooth. He does a great job of attacking leverage. And of course, with that big frame, you know he's not scared to go over the middle. So time and time again, you'll see Kellen Mond work him on in-breaking routes, working away from outside leverage defenders like he did right there.
Kellen Mond, 7 of 8, over 100 yards and a touchdown. Facing pressure here, but gets rid of the pass. And wide open is Smith in Florida territory. Anaya Smith able to find an open seam in the secondary, and it's a 30-yard gain.
Nobody covered him. Off play action, you have a bit of a flood concept, a three-layer concept. This is the second layer. Nobody is around Anaya Smith, and he gets in the open field. If you're Florida, you might want to account for number zero. Like Holly said, I think he is their most dynamic weapon offensively and is a star. Well, he's becoming a star here in college football. It'll be a household name sooner than later.
42 receiving yards on three catches so far. From the 30-yard line, going to go back to the other running back, Spiller. And boy, he gets 9 yards against the Florida defense, which has struggled over 600 yards against Ole Miss. Week one, averaging 30 points per game allowed this year, 16 a year ago. I know it's early, but they're trying to find themselves defensively. On second and short, they snap it quickly and get the first down with Spiller to the 19.
And I think Florida, what's so troubling and what's so concerning, if you're Todd Grant and the defensive coordinator, is the personnel's not there. Jonathan Gennard, there's no one right now that can come close to taking over as a pass rusher. And you look at Kair Elam, and yeah, he's happy that they won, but they're not playing anywhere near what they need to be playing like on defense, they need some guys to emerge, whether it's Brenton Cox or Jeremiah Moon. Todd Grantham has to identify that difference maker in the front like they've had forever. Haven't found that guy just yet.
Play fake, Mon with Moon in his face, throws another pass that's on target. And Marco Wilson throwing Caleb Chapman out of bounds after a pickup of four. Florida did lose three players that were drafted in the first three rounds. Number 9 overall, C.J. Henderson. I mean, Dan Mullen said, look, offenses are ahead of the defense because of all the disruptions and interruptions in practice time and players having to go through COVID protocol, some testing positive, having to quarantine. He just feels like in college football, offenses are way ahead.
It's tough to create tackling, you know, when you're concerned about contact tracing and among other things.
Mond on second and 6, long throw for Chapman through his hands. That was pretty good coverage by Elam. Third down.
And this is where you really miss those guys from last year. Jonathan Bernard, C.J. Henderson, obvious passing situations where you can create a pass rush. Pretty good throw, pretty good coverage there. Chapman's just not able to extend and try to make a play on the back shoulder. But these are the spots right here, obvious passing situations where Florida just hasn't been the same. The coverage hasn't been as tight. The pressure hasn't been as aggressive. And as a result, opposing quarterbacks have had a lot of time to kind of pick this secondary apart. So see if they can get home with a 3-man rush here.
They go empty, flexing Anaya Smith out top of your screen. Mond looking the other way and has Chapman inside the 10, first down. Caleb Chapman had 5 catches all year coming into this game. He has 4 in the first half on 6 targets. And I'm trying to go up tempo here, get to the line at first and goal. Smith in the backfield this time. And he'll get it. And he's met at the 4-yard line. Kept his feet, lost the ball. I thought he was down, thought the ball hit the ground as well. It's recovered in the end zone by Brad Stewart of Florida. Boy, it certainly looked like Smith was down. He might have been down after the initial hit at the 4-yard line.
I think he was down as he tried to extend and reach that ball over the goal line.
The ruling on the field is the ball carrier was down before losing possession at the 1-yard line. Second down.
And great second effort. Again, I thought he was down initially after first contact, but kept the feet moving, stretched the ball out. Second and goal from the 1.
Looked like the contact with the ground is what dislodged the football, but got to be smart there if you're Anaya Smith. Not worth trying to reach it.
Smith. This time second effort won't get him anything. In fact, he'll lose yardage. Good surge defensively by the Gators.
Here's the play just a second ago. A great second effort here. This is where he reaches out. Oh, he almost crossed it. Surprised they didn't take a look at that, see if he crossed the plane potentially as well.
Yeah. Yep. This drive started inside the Texas A&M 10.
Long, time-consuming drives by both teams here in the first half.
Right, almost an 8-minute drive by Florida. This is a 7-minute possession by A&M.
What is this in college football today? I mean, I feel like it's all tempo. If you don't score in 2 minutes, it barely counts.
On third and goal, Mond looks. Chapman got another one. Touchdown. Caleb Chapman has become the favorite target today of Kellen Mond.
It's a great throw, play action. You get a little bit of an influence on those linebackers who are thinking run. But Chapman being the tall 6'5" target in the back of the end zone, perfectly thrown where his guy's gonna go up and snag it. Excellent design and a great drive from Texas A&M.
And we are tied. Kellen Mond was challenged this week. But boy, as he stepped up, 2 touchdown passes, only 2 incompletions, both touchdowns on third down. The all-time passing leader in Texas A&M history, over 8,000 yards, just past Gerard Johnson, Dave Pash, Greg McElroy, Holly Rowe. He's always put up numbers going back to his freshman year. He's basically a 4-year starter, but the one thing that's been absent is the big win. And yeah. I don't know if they're going to win this today, but he's playing winning football right now, Brett.
I tell you what, he's in a nice rhythm. I mean, so far, very accurate with the football, making great decisions. And he's done a good job of locating the football, too. And it's not like all these passes have been routine. I mean, he's been making difficult throws look easy today. So in a really nice rhythm here after what was a pretty disappointing performance last week against Alabama.
Back to the studio, Laura.
ACC action today, also with the SEC in action. Some teams with an opportunity to make a statement, and North Carolina doing just that. You see that Javonte Williams 19-yard touchdown run. It was 21-0 North Carolina heading into the second quarter. Virginia Tech has scored moments ago in this LSU-Missouri game. That's Eric Gilbert just catching that touchdown pass, putting LSU back ahead. Guys, LSU has 0 rush yards through the first quarter and beginning of the second.
A lot different than they had last year, as that pass is caught by Justin Shorter. Penn State transfer picks up about 4 yards. And that game moved from Baton Rouge to Missouri and moved to an earlier start. It was supposed to be a 9 o'clock Eastern game. Second and 6 for Trask, who's been terrific so far. Steps up here and passes incomplete. Late flag. There was a lot of contact between Miles Jones and the receiver Justin Shorter. The flag was thrown in their direction.
They're going to get a hold, I think. Defensively.
Holding defense number 0. The 10-yard penalty with an automatic first down.
So that's Miles Jones. So they've had, you know, 3 bad penalties so far. You had the roughing the passer. I know that was early on the drive, but still, roughing the passer on the last touchdown drive. He had the late hit out of bounds after a touchdown, which hurts you in terms of field position for the kickoff, and then defensive holding. Run play on first and 10 to the third string back, Naquan Wright. A freshman from Miami Gardens, Florida, brought down by Jaden Peavy after a short game.
This might be a situation for Florida. You're moving the ball great through the air, but you haven't really tried a whole lot on the ground. Your defense is gassed. They were just on the field for 7 minutes. So play a little slower, see if you can create some opportunities in the run game, allow that defense to recover a little bit after the long Aggie touchdown drive.
I saw Pitts on the sideline there. Play fake here for Trask, setting up on a crossing route at Shorter, getting the first down into A&M territory, down to the 41-yard line. I mean, if I'm Florida, I'm keeping Kyle Pitts out there like Jimmy Butler, playing 47 minutes last night for the Miami Heat. Don't forget, we'll have game 6 of the NBA Finals tomorrow, 7:30 Eastern on ABC. What a win for Butler. Grew up in Tomball, Texas, about an hour from Bryan College Station, just north of Houston. Trask on first down. In trouble, gets hit and throws the ball away. Was he outside the pocket there? No grounding. Now LeBron James at 40 points, but Jimmy Butler a 35-point triple-double. And so it'll be game 6. Coverage starting with NBA Countdown, 7 Eastern, 4 Pacific. Yesterday in our conversation with Texas A&M, Buddy Johnson had on the Black Mamba Laker jersey. And that's what the Lakers wore last night. You asked him, are you going to wear it again if they lose? He said, I'm wearing it.
He said, closeout night, I'm wearing it. I said, I love it.
Here's Wright, able to get to the outside. Some nice cuts in space. And a first down for Florida at the 30-yard line. Gain of 10 for Naquan Wright, who only had 5 carries coming into today. So don't know if there's an injury to Davis or Pierce, but Wright getting some action here in the second quarter.
And if I'm Florida right here, 30-yard line, have a nice drive going, I'm going play action, I'm throwing the ball down the field. This would be a shot down for me where I would try to take the top off the defense. See if I can't throw one over their heads.
Midway through the second quarter, a tie game here at Kyle Field. Trask hands it off. Right, good patience. Breaks a tackle on the perimeter. And down to the 20-yard line. That's spilled by Michael Clemens, who is roaring backside. dropped him, but it's another pickup of 10 for Wright.
This Florida team, if they can start running the ball like this, I mean, look out, because we already know that passing game is dynamic. And you have to pay a lot of attention in the secondary to their weapons on the outside. But if they can start running it with a lot of consistency, this gets a pretty good defensive line for Texas A&M. They can get some movement against these guys. It's going to bode really, really well as they continue on in the season.
They're sticking with Wright here on this possession as they're in the red zone. Play fake for Trask. And it's caught by Gamble, number two tight end. He's out of bounds at the 14-yard line. Again, this is normally where you see Kyle Pitts getting targeted, but he's not even in the game right now. Still on the sideline on this drive.
Is Florida just trying to say, hey, we can still move it without him too? Is that like, is this like a statement drive for them? Amazing.
Right, leveled at the line of scrimmage. Fell forward for a yard. That's a big hit by Johnson. Leading tackler for the last 2 years, senior from Dallas.
Third down's been a problem for this A&M defense so far in the red zone here. Third short. Have to get off the field. They need to account for Kadarius Toney. He's the best weapon now offensively with Kyle Pitts on the sideline.
Look at both teams on third down. Well, defense is not able to get off the field. That's Toney in motion, and that's where the ball is going. It's caught at the 10. Forward progress was very close to a first down. Looks like he's got it. At the 10-yard line, it will be first and goal for the Gators. Another third down conversion. You do wonder too about the conditioning still of these guys, and it's very humid today. Maybe that's a reason they're giving Pitts a break here for the entire drive.
They always roll a lot of guys. Played a lot last year. I know they lost four receivers, but they felt good with the experience coming back because of how they substitute, how they rotate their players.
Here's Toney on an inside handoff, and Toney showing that burst. And he got through the hole, and it took off and gets close to 9 yards on the carry. Pitts coming into the game here in goal line.
Pretty cool little design right here. Just try to go almost like a counter action with the blocker out in front for Toney. He had a big run against Ole Miss, 50-yarder. So he can do it not just through the air, but also on the ground as well.
Toney may be shaken up as well. Second down and goal. Here's Wright. Finds a hole and is into the end zone for the Florida touchdown. The first for the freshman, Naquan Wright. McPherson with a point after, and Florida leads now 21-14. Kyle Trask with two touchdown passes. Now they get a rushing score with Naquan Wright.
Young people across America are finding their voice.
Thank you, Holly, so much. Kickoff will sail out the back of the end zone for a touchback. A&M down 7, has possession late in the second quarter. Kyle Field. Everybody talking about De'Aaron King and Miami. Are the Canes for real? We will certainly find out tonight. Clemson looks machine-like as usual.
Is Miami back? It's like, how many times have we answered that question? I love it, though, don't you? I mean, I would love for them to get back. I would love for that game to be exceptionally competitive, even for Clemson too, just to see where they're at. You know, I mean, it's been easy for the dominant ACC team for a while.
Here's Kellen Mond going back to work. Hit as he throws deep, almost picked off by diving Sean Davis. Definitely the contact in the face of the quarterback altered that throw. Mond has been Nothing short of spectacular so far, but an errant throw there.
Yeah, all set up by the pressure, though. If you really look at that pressure up front, I mean, Mons trying to throw a difficult throw with no one in your lap, let alone someone all over you. Almost intercepted. Fortunate. Davis wasn't able to close on it in time.
Just outside 4 minutes to go. A&M with all of its timeouts left here. Another pass play for Mond. And Mond and Caleb Chapman have something going here. Chapman, again, had 5 catches coming into today through 2 games. He has more than that in this game alone, a sophomore. 6'5", 200 pounds, got to put on some weight, but obviously they're pretty high on this kid.
No question about it. And if I'm Mond, man, I'm just going to pound the flats right there. And they're playing off, soft coverage. Over the top of Chapman. Remember, he burned him deep on the first drive, so clearly he has their respect. But if they're going to play that far off, man, throw hitch after hitch after hitch, 5, 6, 7, 8 yards at a time.
From the 35-yard line, Spiller. Down at the 40-yard line, Sean Davis coming in there late with the big hit. Pickup of 5 yards.
It's an important drive here for Texas A&M, not just to try to get points of their own. Their offense has been in great rhythm so far throughout the course of this game, but also being mindful of how good Florida is offensively as well. You have to at least think about scoring points while also making sure that if you give the ball back to the Gators, it's with very little time remaining. So working it on both sides here is Kellen Mond, the senior quarterback.
Haven't had a punt yet, haven't had a stop on third down yet. Another run play, and Spiller's got room across midfield. Out of bounds at the 43-yard line. A 17-yard run for Isaiah Spiller. Came in averaging 8 yards a pop. Last year as a true freshman at 4 100-yard games on the ground. We talk a lot about Anaya Smith for good reason, but Spiller's a talented sophomore in his own right.
Great 1-2 punch here at running back. And Spiller, not to be outdone, he can certainly have a huge impact to the game as well.
We'll go with Spiller again, straight ahead, grabbed by Ventrell Miller and stopped at the 40-yard line as we hit the 2-minute mark here in the first half. Again, A&M with all of its timeouts. Pickup of 3 on first down.
Jimbo Fisher. He surveys his offense, telling him maybe smart. Nice rhythm, nice tempo for this time in the game. And already pretty close to field goal range. You got to be really smart if you're Kellen Mond. And any drop back you have, you got to get rid of the football. No sacks in the spot.
Here's a blitz. Mond does get rid of it, and it's almost picked off at the 35-yard line by Mahmoud Diabate. Stepped in front of the receiver. Another clock stop with 1:27 to go. 3rd and 7. Jimbo Fisher trying to get his first win against a top 5 team at A&M. Those losses by an average of 19 points per game. Kellen Mond has been outstanding so far in third down. 5 of 5 with 2 touchdowns. It's 3rd and 7 here on the Florida 40. And they're going to talk about it on the A&M sideline. First timeout taken by Texas A&M. Has been more impacted by not having fans at the event than college football, without question. I mean, look at 2019. 2020, no tailgating. You got to go back to 1972. Well, the last time they had a crowd that was under 30,000. We're used to 100,000 plus here in this place rocking. You've got to wonder how it impacts these student athletes. Home for the home players that normally feed off the crowd. Sometimes the road team will use that to get them jacked up for a game and inspired. Big third down here. A&M trying to keep this drive going. Ball on the 40-yard line. Gator showing blitz. No surprise with Todd Grantham calling the defense. And here they come. It's picked up. Mond's pass is caught. That was a great grab at the 30-yard line by Chase Lane to pick up the first down.
Great job by Kellen Mond, identifying that pressure, using the hard count to his advantage, knowing where his quick throw was, the outlet throw, and putting it perfectly in stride for Chase Lane. Great poise there, taking advantage of the aggressiveness of the Florida defense.
Mond from the pocket, long throw into double coverage, and he overshoots Anaya Smith. 58 seconds to go. A&M still with two timeouts left. They do have confidence in their kicker, Seth Small, who's made a 52-yarder in his career.
Knowing you have three timeouts to rely on as well. You don't have to necessarily throw it here. You could potentially catch him off guard if you see a favorable look in the run game. Hand it off. It's no problem, especially knowing how talented those running backs are. So it's not an absolute must that you have to throw it. Now that you spent a timeout, it's looking like it's going to be a throw-a-thon these next couple downs.
30-second timeout.
Our next UFC Fight Night main event is tonight from Fight Island. Number one ranked bantamweight contender Marlon Moraes squares off against number four Corey Sandhagen. The prelim started 5 Eastern with the main card at 8 on ESPN Plus in English and Spanish. It's kind of interesting that A&M took two timeouts while the clock was stopped. Just got to get points when you think about halftime against Alabama last week. A&M's got to come away with something here, especially since it's been so difficult to stop Florida's offense. Seth Small's career long, as we mentioned, 52. He's attempted 3 kicks this year, made 2. And Jimbo told us yesterday he was pretty comfortable from 55 with Small.
No wind here, nothing that would affect the kicking game. So. And quite warm, too, so ball should fly. If you're Kellen Mond, you're not thinking about the field goal just yet.
Right. I still think he could even run it here. I mean, you got 58 seconds left, a 2nd and 10.
If you have favorable numbers in the run game, quarterback draw here is actually a good play. I mean, you have 5 guys in the tackle box. Quarterback run's actually really, really inviting if they decide to go that direction.
Nope, Mond will throw it. Wide open receiver is Lane, and he gets a 1st down. That's going to stop the clock to reset the chain to the 19. But how about the cushion the Florida DBs gave Chase Lane there?
Yeah, just trying to keep everything in front of the Florida Gator defenders. Not wanting to give them the big play.
Mond, long throw, overshoots Cam Brown. That was a line drive. Going to be tough for Brown to pull in that one. Needed a ladder. 38 seconds left, 2nd and 10.
Main thing you're thinking here if you're Kellen Mond, I like the fact that he got the ball out of his hands right there quickly. Hey, it wasn't there. Throw it over his head, no problem. Live to play another down. You absolutely cannot take a sack. Actually, it takes me back to the game in between New England and Kansas City on Monday. Brian Hoyer took a sack at the end of the half, and it really impacted the momentum they went into halftime with. So you cannot take a sack if you're Kellen Mond. The ball has to come out, and knowing that Florida is very capable of bringing pressure and blitz packages, you got to have answers for everything they might throw at you.
They had 8 sacks the first 2 games. Here's Mond with time, open receiver, but going to the ground is Lane, and the clock is moving here. 30 seconds and counting. It's 3rd down. They're not going to use that timeout here. So 3rd down and 6 on the 15 with the clock at 20 seconds. Florida rushes 3. Mond looks, caught inside the 5. Fox will stop. They'll get rid of the chains, and then they'll run it with 11 seconds left. You still have a timeout. You can spike it.
Yeah, spike it.
Mond will spike it. 8 seconds left. I almost think, Greg, why not use the timeout? I guess the danger is if you take a sack, then on the next play, the half's over. But now you get probably 2 shots instead of maybe 3 with 11 seconds left.
Yeah, you don't need that additional down. I mean, it doesn't matter. So now you preserve the right. Knowing you have that timeout, you have a field goal in your back pocket. It's done. So you got your whole playbook here. If you want to run it, you want to throw it, you want to get Mond on the move, the only thing you got to be mindful of is ball security.
This is College Football on ESPN, presented by Geico, as we continue Dr. Pepper's Championship Drive Game of the Week.
That timeout right there, I mean, you just basically wasted the fact that you spiked it, and you could have had three additional seconds. So,
right. And now you don't have the timeout if there's a sack.
To call multiple timeouts when the clock is stopped in a two-minute operation is not good.
All three timeouts were taken with a clock stop, so I don't know what's going on there. But that made no sense. All right, this season, for every field goal, an extra point made by participating universities, Allstate will make a contribution to the university's general scholarship fund. Thank you, Allstate. With Greg McElroy and Holly Rowe, Dave Pash in Bryan College Station. That's what it's called now. It's not just College Station anymore. They've merged Bryan and College Station, the Twin Cities here. Got a third. Check that, second and goal on the four. And again, A&M out of timeouts.
So obviously every throw you make has to be in the end zone. You lose the ability because you burn that timeout to run the football.
Right.
Likely wouldn't here anyways, given the down and distance and where you're at on the field. You got two shots. Ball has to come out quick. It's got to be thrown in an isolation to the outside, and hopefully one of your tall wide receivers come down with it for Texas A&M.
Mond has not been as sharp on this drive as he was for most of the first half, as Florida is going to call for time here after they saw the alignment by Texas A&M. But overall, Kellen Mond has been excellent, as has Kyle Trask. Trask and Pitts connecting on the game's first touchdown on a lengthy opening drive by Florida. Went 17 plays, 75 yards. Again, we have not had a punt. Every drive has ended in a touchdown.
One of the worst offensive drive we've seen today has been 71 yards. You feel pretty good. As an offensive guy, I'm thoroughly enjoying this matchup. Now, if you are a special teams enthusiast, probably not your cup of tea.
Right. If you love punting, this game is not for you.
But you happen to love punting, Dave, so I'm sorry that the game's not going the way you want it to.
All right, 8 seconds to go. No timeouts for A&M.
Based on the alignment of Florida, with all those guys up at the line of scrimmage, looks like they might bring all-out pressure, too. Let's see if they bluff. They'll drop someone out underneath the throw, potentially over the middle, but this is a pressure look from the Gators.
And here they come. Mond gets rid of it. Broken up. Incomplete, but a flag. So Sean Davis, who was defending Weidermeyer, the tight end that they were trying to hit there in the end zone, committed the penalty. So 4 seconds left. It's only going to get you 2 yards. It's not the worst penalty in the world.
Pass interference, defense, number 6. Foul occurred in the end zone. By rule, the ball will be placed at the 2-yard line. Carries an automatic first down.
And so you get the automatic first down, you get a couple yards, but, I mean, there's only 4 seconds left. It's not the worst penalty in the world. And interesting here. They're gonna kick with 4 seconds. I guess you're taking a risk with one more shot. Right? Too risky.
Well, that's why the penalty kills you. Or the having to take the timeout because you didn't have a play lined up kills you. And you would easily send it out there if you didn't. If you weren't out of timeouts.
And Seth Small knocks it through to end the first half, but kind of ugly clock management. Don't know again if that's on the players or the coaching staff there, but poor use of the timeouts. They do get 3. 21-17, number 4 Florida, leading at 21st ranked Texas A&M as we go to the studio. Biggest win of the Jimbo Fisher era as we welcome you back to the SEC on ESPN. But the 4th ranked Gators in front, 21-17. Kellen Mond has been terrific, though, in the first, as has Kyle Trask. Brilliant quarterback play here this afternoon in College Station.
These guys have been off the charts. Kellen Mond challenged coming into this ball game. Man, he's been accurate. He's been decisive. He's had a couple opportunities to throw the ball down the field and has delivered on those opportunities. And Kyle Trask is as advertised. Great job throwing to Kyle Pitts there on the touchdown on the opening drive and then finding Kadarius Toney. both these quarterbacks so far really in rhythm. A combined 29 of 40 at the quarterback position for well over 335 yards, four touchdowns.
First half stats. Brought to you by Zaxby's. And boy, check out third down. It's crazy. Have you ever seen that before?
The quarterbacks make their money on third down. That's really what it comes down to. And as advertised, both these quarterbacks playing extremely well, very efficient on third down. And on the one that Florida didn't convert third down on, they got it on fourth and one. So really been a fun first half if you love offense and love excellent quarterback play.
A&M will get the ball to start the third quarter. Fair caught, and so touchback. It will come out to the 25-yard line. Dave Pasch back with Greg McElroy and Holly Rowe on the field. Boy, it seems like in this game it's going to come down to the first team to force a punt might end up winning.
It does, doesn't it? I mean, it's been amazing. So in line, and what I've been pretty amazed with, too, is Florida's willingness to run the football, just given the looks that that Texas A&M's defense is throwing at him. And Kellen Mond, like we just mentioned a second ago, he was really challenged by this staff throughout the course of this past week. We have to start hitting some downfield throws is what they told him, and he did it. First drive of the game, he throws an absolute dart to Caleb Chapman for nearly a 50-yard gain. So it's been really impressive to see the offensive fireworks here in the first 30 minutes.
Caleb Chapman at 80 receiving yards on six catches and a touchdown. Wide open out of the backfield to Spiller, and Florida's defensive issues continue all the way to the 43 for 18 yards. Let's check with Holly Rowe.
Well, a personnel issue is what caused Texas A&M to have to call that timeout and have some issues with managing the clock to end that first half. Jimbo said they didn't have somebody there that was supposed to run out on the field right then. He thought they also got a bad spot. He said, I thought we were supposed to be on the two. They marked the ball back a little further. He was also being very cautious about not leaving the Gators any time. So didn't go perfectly, but he wasn't too upset with how they ended that first half. They did get the score, and they have the ball back here.
Yep, and that was the only non-touchdown drive of that first half. But good first play to start the third. Here's Mond to the air again, and the pass deflected and incomplete. Kair Elam, sophomore corner, coming off the edge, got a piece of the football.
And this was a theme there towards the end of the first half from Florida. They started to ramp up their pressure packages here. Corner blitz off the right-hand side. Kair Elam does a great job of going vertical, attacking the quarterback's throwing arm and getting a hand on the football. With the absence of an elite pass rusher, Todd Grantham's going to have to resort more to pressures, to blitzes. And that's exactly what he did as the first half went along. They haven't been able to get home, so hopefully here in the second half they can find some pressure and disrupt the rhythm of Kellen Mond.
They bring pressure again. It's a run play and a big hole for Spiller. Picks up the first down. A gain of 11 to the 44 of Florida. Boy, I thought we'd be calling Brenton Cox's name more. The transfer from Georgia kind of ran right at him here.
Yeah, they did. And a great job, too, up front along the offensive line. Texas A&M's coaching staff, offensive coordinator Darrell Dickey, he said, man, look, we're really close in the run game. I'm really proud of our offensive line. It's a veteran group that has done a nice job of keeping Kellen Mond's jersey clean and opening up some opportunities in the run game here.
Mond with a ton of time. The pass is underthrown and incomplete. Ventrell Miller almost picked that off. They were going for the tight end Weidermeyer. And good coverage by the junior linebacker from Lakeland, Florida.
Man, this is a great job by Ventrell Miller. Ball was thrown just the littlest bit off target, but when you get a tight end with the skill set of Weidermeyer against a middle linebacker, your eyes as a quarterback get wide. You think, oh my goodness, I'm going to exploit that matchup. No, not so much. Ventrell Miller, excellent job in coverage, nearly intercepting that pass.
Empty set here. You saw Spiller leaving the backfield. Second down, Florida showing blitz. Here they come. Mond's pass off the mark. Incomplete. Going for Chapman, who had that big first half. And now it's third down and 10 for A&M.
All right, get ready. Double move's coming. Double move, stop and go is coming. Kair Elam saw about five or six hitch routes thrown right in front of him there throughout the first half. Chapman was the recipient of many of them. That time he jumped that hitch route, and it was almost intercepted. So get ready here in the second half. At some point, I'll make you a guarantee. They will run a little stop and go at number five. Kair Elam, take advantage of that aggressiveness.
And there's some confusion by Florida right now in the secondary. They're going to call a timeout. Several of the DBs were looking around.
Timeout, Florida, the first of the half.
I get it, third and 10. Don't want to make a mistake here and allow a big play. But we'll see if down the stretch that burning of the timeout comes back to haunt the Gators. So week three of the SEC season. Florida 2-0, Texas A&M 1-1. Three teams in the top five, seven in the top 25. No surprise. That includes now the Big Ten of the Pac-12. Boy, Alabama. Defense looks like it's back. We'll see. Mac Jones tremendous last week. Tennessee puts an eight-game winning streak on the line against Georgia later today. And so far, the quarterback play. A lot of guys that weren't household names coming into the year starting to make a name for themselves.
If you had Stetson Bennett on that graphic in the preseason, you deserve a trophy, because I don't think I expected that. And you look at some of these matchups here throughout the course of the day and some of the matchups that we're going to have over the course of the season. We don't see these very often. Missouri and LSU obviously playing today. Florida and A&M, they've only played three times since A&M's been in the league, right. One of which was Johnny Manziel's coming out party in 2012.
Yeah, that was the last time Florida was here.
Yeah, pretty amazing.
A&M won in Gainesville 2017. Kellen Mond was the quarterback.
This 10-game SEC schedule is spoiling me. Some of the matchups we're getting, I'm loving it. Seeing these compelling and interesting matchups every week.
I don't think you're alone. Here's Mond on third down and 10. Gets hit as he throws. Incomplete. It was Brenton Cox. We kept waiting to call his name. It's the first time, and it's on third down and 10 as he got a piece of Kellen Mond to force an errant throw. And ladies and gentlemen, we have a punter on the field.
And this is just an overload of pressure. You're going to see three rushers here and only two blockers for Texas A&M. So that means Kellen Mond's got to throw hot. You see only two blockers on the left side of the offensive line. Brenton Cox is unblocked. Todd Grantham starting to ramp up the pressure packages for that Gator defense.
Constantino with an excellent punt. The Aggies all over it, and so Florida will be backed up on its 10-yard line. 36-yard punt. Gator football with a four-point lead. Let's take a look at this week's college football rankings brought to you by Goodyear. Clemson in Miami tonight on ABC, number one versus number seven, our ESPN prime game. Second-ranked Alabama taking on Lane Kiffin, the former Bama offensive coordinator. At Ole Miss, Georgia, Tennessee, we talked about that. Notre Dame looks pretty good early on. Florida State has not. Ohio State still a couple of weeks away from getting started with its season. How about North Carolina? Virginia Tech.
Make a statement. We saw them last week. They got some firepower on offense.
Trask hands it off on first down to Pierce. And he's pushed back by Buddy Johnson after a short gain. Might give him four, depending on forward progress. Well, Florida taking its seventh straight win, fifth consecutive SEC win, would be its longest since 2012. And we talked a lot about Jimbo Fisher in his third year, but Dan Mullen in year three. Obviously, was at Florida previously as the offensive coordinator, Urban Meyer. Won a couple of championships. Got Florida in major bowl games the last 2 years. Their last SEC title, though, was 2008. Pierce again. And second effort gets the first down of the 21. And it's not just Dan Mullen. He's got a great staff around him. He's got an excellent young coordinator in Brian Johnson, former player who was recruited by Dan Mullen and Urban Meyer at Utah. First black offensive coordinator in Florida program history.
I joked with Dan Mullen. I said, hey, the offense finally going. Wanna know why? You went to Texas. You got your coordinator, Brian Johnson, who's from Baytown Lee. And you got Kyle Trask, who's from Manville.
Homecoming for Trask, throwing a deep ball to double coverage, and it's intercepted. An easy pick for O'Neal, bringing it back inside the 35. They finally track him down at the 31. There is a penalty flag, though, in the backfield.
Personal foul, hands to the face, defense, number two. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Michael Clemens, and that's the second roughing and a personal foul penalty that we've seen in this game. This very costly as it takes an interception away from O'Neal.
Yeah, it's on the right side. You see right there, Clemens with that right arm up into the face mask of Kyle Pitts. And man, that's an unfortunate penalty there. They had a nice pass rush, and for the first time, Kyle Trask really forced an awful throw into bad coverage, into good coverage. So, fortunate break there from the Florida Gators offense.
Might be his worst throw of the season. I mean, spectacular at this point. First down after the penalty, a wide receiver screen to Grimes, who shakes a defender at the 40 into A&M territory and pushed out of bounds at the 43-yard line. Boy, that's a play that should have gained about 5 yards, and instead it gains about 20.
You go back, just that's the third major penalty against Texas A&M. They had a rough in the passer. They had a late hit. They have a hands in the face there that erases an interception. So, pivotal penalty so far from the Aggies. They've erased some good defensive plays.
Then you go back to the clock management, too, at the end of the first half. A lot of issues for A&M, yet still in the game, but can they get a stop? Florida's in A&M territory. Here's Trask looking, facing pressure, steps up, and brought down at the 40, so he did get positive yardage, a gain of 3 on the play. We have not seen Emory Jones at all. The reason is he's not here. Jones was dressed but didn't play last week. He's normally the backup quarterback. So if something were to happen to Trask, it'd be a true freshman, Gainesville native Anthony Richardson, that would go in the game. We were not given a reason by the program as to why Emory Jones isn't here, but not available is what we were told. Second and 7. Run play, and Davis brought down after a pickup of about 2. A little extracurricular activity as well. And then you see flags fly as players fly over the pile. This ends up being on A&M. Jimbo might lose it. It looked like Stuart Reese shoved an A&M player after the play, though, but doesn't mean that that's what the officials saw. Maybe they saw more than that. Yeah, you saw Leal go flying. Stuart Reese, a grad transfer from Mississippi State, played for Dan Mullen there before Mullen took the Florida job a couple of years ago. Here's Reese at the end of the play, lighting up Leal.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, number 51 for Florida. We also have unsportsmanlike conduct, number 9 for Texas A&M. Both of those fouls will cancel. It's their first unsportsmanlike to the game. Be third down.
So offsetting penalties.
There was definitely some extracurricular there on the pile. Leal, as you see, kind of pushing down DeLance, the right tackle, and then his running mate, Reese.
But what are you doing coming, if you're Leon O'Neal?
You can't do it. You just can't react like that after, and you want to protect your guy. That's your instinct, right? To protect your guy, but you've got to allow cooler heads to prevail. That's a game-changing penalty, perhaps.
Trask on third down and 4. Throws a deep ball. He's got Tony. It's caught. It's a touchdown. You said game-changing penalty, but Leon O'Neal couldn't hold his water. He got a penalty too. They offset. Seconds later, it's a 37-yard touchdown to make it a 10-point game.
Guess who the touchdown was against? Leon O'Neal. He was in coverage as Kadarius Toney ran right past him. And a beautiful throw, beautiful catch. Excellent execution there, taking advantage there of the mistake by the Aggies.
And the extra point makes it an 11-point game. And if you're trying to beat a top 5 team, you can't make the mistakes that Texas A&M has made today. Give Kyle Trask some credit, though, too. He's made some pinpoint passes, 3 more touchdowns, 13 through 2.5 games. Will Florida now pull away after that touchdown? Up 11, early third quarter. Obviously a ton of time left, but mistakes killing Texas A&M. Kyle Trask, though, another phenomenal performance. 15 of 20, 195 yards and three touchdowns. And then we'll start this drive at its 25. Bad penalties by Texas A&M, and it wasn't just on that last possession. There's some pushing and shoving here. More flags go flying in. We'll get to that in a second, but here's Trask getting hit, a late hit earlier on Bobby Brown. This was an interception by Trask, but they called illegal hands to the face on the last drive. And then after another penalty, there was a touchdown pass to Tony just moments ago. And then after the kickoff, which did not have a run back, there was pushing and shoving, which drew a penalty flag.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, number 32, Texas A&M, his first of the game. Penalties half the distance to the goal, first down.
I mean, this is borderline embarrassing. It's just because they're happening on top of each other. That's Andre White. I mean, again, there was no return on the play.
Yeah, and it was dumb too. Andre White, after the play, and you see Wright right there, number four, trying to pull Andre White out of there. And Andre White after the play, you'll see him. He gets knocked down, pancaked, and then he comes right in, heads butts number 24 for Florida, which obviously leads to the official throwing the flag. Man, you just can't lose your composure. Can't do it. Florida's too good. You're giving them free plays, free opportunities. A&M can't seem to get out of their own way.
And so now backed up at the 13-yard line. And granted, that was, you know, a big hit by Iverson Clement, but Jimbo Fisher now calling a timeout. Wow. Okay. Step aside. 28-17 Florida. Moments ago. Sideline, the coach is doing all the talking. You see a tap on the helmet to Kellen Mond-Craig as a former national championship quarterback, winning it as a veteran player. Kellen Mond being a senior, how would you handle this moment?
I would personally have gone over and ripped the entire team. I would have gathered everybody up on the sideline. I would have said, hey, y'all, we are shooting ourselves in the foot. We have only stopped ourselves offensively, and we have given Florida so many times. Now, Kellen Mond's a different type of leader. He's very relaxed. He's very calm. He's very even-keeled as it relates to how he talks to his guys. But Jimbo Fisher's that demonstrative personality. I think he just got to settle the team down right now. Let's put a drive together. Let's feel good offensively. The offense has been playing quite well, but everybody wearing a Texas A&M jersey right now needs to calm down just a little bit because emotions are flaring and it's costing them.
So after the penalty, back up on their 13-yard line. Out of the pistol. Mond will hand it off to Spiller. Ton of room off the left edge. Out past the 25. So a gain of 13 on the play. Tomorrow it is Sunday NFL Countdown. Randy Moss, of course, ranking the best catches from today's college games. Plus an inside look at how the postgame jersey exchange is evolving this season. Kick off your Sunday morning with NFL Countdown, 10 a.m. Eastern on ESPN. Got a doubleheader of Monday Night Football on ESPN as well. Nine minutes to play here in the third. 10th carry of the day for Spiller, and again a ton of running room as he runs over a defender. Man, we've seen that twice out of Isaiah Spiller.
Let's go, baby.
Gain of 23.
How about this right side of the offensive line? I mean, we're talking about just an absolute gash. These guys on the right side between Carson Green, South Lake Carroll's own, by the way, and Jared Hawker have done a fantastic job of moving some of these Florida Gators off the spot. It's been a real physical look so far by that right side of the offensive line. Expect them to continue to lean on that as game goes along and fatigue starts to set in potentially for Florida's defense.
Good way to work in the Dragons.
Yeah, South Lake Carroll, man. Come on, Dragons.
Here he is again, getting the perimeter past the 40. Boy, he is not afraid. Look at him lower the shoulder, and a big hitter in Sean Davis. Man, Isaiah Spiller taking names here. 6'1", 225-pound back. Check in with Holly.
Guys, talking about depth here in the second half, Florida is without some second-string guys that would give them that depth. Defensive end or buck position, Chris Bogle, number 8, is out today. So is C.J. McWilliams, a backup corner. And, guys, they're going to have to overcome some depth issues up front, especially with Tyree Campbell as well missing this game.
I imagine it's getting hotter down there too. Holly, pretty hot and humid up here. Spiller with running room again. He is feeling it down to the 33, 5 or 6 on that carry.
Guys, I can tell you it is really heating up here. The sun is beating down straight overhead right now, and you can see guys putting their hands on their hips. They're completely sweated through their uniforms, and it is starting to be oppressive here in this heat.
It was kind of a weird day. It started, it was like 60 and foggy, and now we're getting close to 90.
And it definitely has an effect. I mean, every coach said with the unusual camp, we are concerned about conditioning, so they might be tested here as the game goes along.
Just going to keep pounding it here. This is Smith, and he's got a first down to the 24-yard line. It's working, so they just keep hammering it against that Florida front.
Just over and over and over again. Let it rip. That right side of the offensive line continue to do work. You see big number 77, Ryan McCollum, the center, doing a nice job there getting his guys' shoulders to turn. Just keep pounding it. If I'm Texas A&M, I don't even think about calling a pass right now. Just pound away with how your offensive line is playing.
All run play so far. Inside the 25, 6 straight run plays, and room again up the middle for Smith. Inside the 20, 6 more yards for Anaya Smith.
I like this too from Texas A&M. You're on the left hash. Keep it on the left hash. That way it's harder for Florida to potentially substitute. He's got to run all the way to the other side of the field. So if I'm Texas A&M, I'm going to continue to run the ball, work the left side of the offensive line, and see if you might be able to find a cutback lane for the dangerous Anaya Smith at running back.
Started the game a wide receiver. Ton of room here with that offensive line blowing Florida's D-line off the ball. And Smith gets a first down to the 12. I mean, he's not even touched until 5 or 6 yards downfield. This is an excellent response by Texas A&M after some of the previous errors.
This is the way you take out frustration, by the way. Right there, the collapse by Florida. The left side of the defensive line kind of falls out of place, and Nia Smith is able to find that backside. This is how you take out frustration. I mean, just pound away. Challenge the offensive line. Let that veteran group lead you.
131 yards on the ground. Smith again. Ball hit the ground there? Hard to tell. Mond actually just kept it. Held on to it as long as possible. Probably should have given it. Lost a yard.
And with that look, Florida said, all right, you're not running it here. That looked like about 9 guys there in the box with their corners on islands to the outside. Let's see if they try to go with that type of defensive alignment again.
Spiller is in at running back. Had over 100 yards week one against Vandy. Play fake, first pass of the drive. Mond dumps it off, wide open Weiermeyer to the 5. Comes up a yard short of the line to gain, but they're inside the Florida 5-yard line with 3rd down coming up.
I love it. And with the way my team's running it right now, if you're Texas A&M, 2 downs to get it. You just challenge your offensive line all the way down the field. And I like that they tried to go with a little misdirection. Thought they might be able to sneak Weidermeyer down into the flats. But Florida was in zone coverage, just trying to keep it in front of them. 2 downs to get it. Challenge that big group up front for the Aggies.
And they will pound it. First down. Touchdown, Isaiah Spiller. Said, that's how you take out your anger. That's how you bounce back, fire your team up. After the mental errors committed in great number today by Texas A&M, but far from being out of this one. The extra point makes it 28-24 with 4:18 remaining in the third.
This Texas A&M team might have just found an identity. They might have just found an offensive identity. Ground and pound and allow your veteran quarterback to take advantage, but allow those big fellas up front to move it. As Spiller says, giggle.
The 12th man is feeling it. Wherever the students are, the Taco Bell Live Moss student section lives. Visit livemossstudentsection.com to learn more. A&M back within 4. will be a touchback. We'll come out to the Florida 25-yard line. All right, time now for our Aflac trivia question.
Aflac.
Texas A&M alum Edwin Kyle used how much of his own money in 1904 to build what would become Kyle Field?
Oh, my goodness. That's
how many
one.
Digits? We need a hint. Like, is it
I'm gonna say,
four digits? Five,
I'm going to say 1904. I'm going to say five digits. Four digits.
I'm going to say $500.
$500?
Yep. 1904. It's like $5 million. Trask pumps in trouble, and down he goes. They finally get to him. Bobby Brown was there. So was Tyree Johnson. Brown hurt himself, too. Is that the Bill Gramatica celebrate injury there from Bobby Brown?
Oh, man, I hope he's okay.
Oh, man.
His teammate kind of pushed him, and it kind of caught him off guard, and that right leg kind of hyperextended. Oh, my goodness.
This is such an important player. First team All-SEC preseason.
Get up, Bobby.
All right, so let's watch here after the sack.
He's fired up. He's moving. Yeah, his teammate, McKinley Jackson, kind of pushed him from
behind. A
little bit,
though. Not much, though, Greg.
Not much. It was just awkward. You can see his right leg. Oh! This young man has worked so hard, Bobby Brown. Get his body in shape, make sure he's in a great spot to have a very impactful junior season. And here he is being helped to the sideline. Man, I hope he's okay. It's a heck of a play he made. And I'd hate to see him get injured on something like that.
A&M's got some momentum now after the 6-yard setback on the sack. First sack of the game for either team. Here's Trask on 2nd and 16, trying to hit Tony. It's incomplete. Third down.
You see Buddy Johnson right there almost tackle his own teammate, because it looked like Jalen Jones is about to celebrate and maybe throw him to the ground. And Buddy Johnson, the senior linebacker, said, no, nothing. Don't celebrate too much, as they're cranked up here at Kyle Field for a pivotal third down.
That is a beautiful sound in 2020, isn't it? Florida, 6 of 7 on third down today, 3rd and 16. Flag down. Play clock at 0. Dan Mullen may have called a timeout before the penalty, which would be the second. Would only leave them with one. The officials are discussing whether it's a delay or a penalty. I almost feel like if I'm Dan Mullen, I'd rather keep that timeout. I mean, you're 3rd and 16. Holly?
Well, guys, here's the weird part of 2020 is it hasn't been that loud at college games around the country with the limited attendance. But in that moment right now, I'm standing about 30 feet away from where Kyle Trask is.
Timeout, Florida.
And it was deafening. The way these fans are here, they feel like they're right on top of us. That's the first time I've heard it get that loud all game. And you can see it caused a delay communicating that play at the line.
Yeah, Kyle Trask was going back and forth from shotgun alignment back to the line of scrimmage, trying to talk to his tight end, trying to get it all communicated. And Kyle's probably like, why are we having such a hard time talking? Kyle, let's call it crowd noise, man. We hadn't heard it in a long time. But as you can see, clearly having an effect is the offensive lineman. You see DeLance having to go back and communicate. And Kyle tries to come up, make an adjustment. Communicate a little bit more. And again,
how much did they work on the silent count this week in practice, right? I mean, there's supposed to be 30,000. Looks like there's probably more here than that, but
clearly not much, because if you look at Florida over the years, they'll do the clap, they'll do all kinds of stuff for their cadence, but this has been the first time, this is our fifth game, it's the first time I feel as though the offense has actually been affected by the crowd and the amount of noise that crowd's providing.
So one timeout remaining now for Dan Mullen for the rest of the game.
Trask on third and 16, gonna dump it off. Wide open is Davis, but he will not get to the line to gain. Well, it's fourth down, and Florida will have to punt the football. Another injured defensive lineman for Texas A&M. That's Tyree Johnson after Bobby Brown went out just a couple of plays ago. So you look at Brown, you've got Tyree Johnson injured. One name we haven't called in a long time is Kyle Pitts. Now, there was a period of time we was on the sideline in the second quarter for a drive, but he's on the day, got 3 catches, 5 targets, but that was all in the first half, and most of that was in the first quarter. I think most of it was on the first drive.
It really was, and they've done a pretty good job of bracketing him. And honestly, if you look at the Florida passing game, I mean, there have been other guys that have stepped up and have done a really nice job. I mean, Kadarius Toney has broken free a couple times. He's been very reliable. Kyle Pitts just been used really more as a decoy here in these last two quarters as opposed to the opening start of the game.
Jacob Finn to punt. Anaya Smith, who's changed his number for the punt return, the number 19, but he's not going to get a look at that. It was a bad punt off the side of the foot of Jacob Finn. A&M has all the momentum. Just a 38-yard punt, most of that coming off that one hop. All right, let's answer the Aflac trivia question.
All right, so you said 501, right? Or you said 500?
$500.
Right, I'll go 501.
$650.
Right.
Hey, come on, man. You can't.
That's a win. Hey, Price is right. You chose first. Closest without going over. That's a winner.
Just think about that. $650 to build a stadium. That's about what Jerry Jones paid in Arlington. Add about 4 more zeros. Goodness. Just think, Greg, if you invest wisely, you never know what you can build.
That's a good point.
Run the ball here on first down. Pick up a couple of yards with Spiller. The breakfast order on the last drive was pancakes. Just have the offensive lineman pancake the D-line, which they did. They try to go back to the run there, and it's only a gain of 2.
Yeah, and this Florida defense has struggled. It's obvious with how they played against Ole Miss. There were some pieces missing, especially in the pass rush, that haven't necessarily materialized just yet. You see today, Texas A&M, at 356 yards isn't going to jump out, but what does jump out is the yards per play. I mean, 7 yards a play. Love to be obviously under 3. So tough time so far for Florida.
They're going to run it again. Spiller able to squeak through a hole, get out to the 39. Let's check in with Laura Rutledge in the studio.
It's been back and forth all afternoon long between Missouri and LSU. Here's Miles Brennan, a 75-yard touchdown pass to Terrace Marshall. That's Marshall's 3rd of the day, his career high. Guys, they moved this game to Columbia because of Hurricane Delta. You wonder if it factors in for LSU.
What do you make of LSU so far? I mean, you knew it was going to be a tall order to come close to what you did a year ago.
Yeah, I mean, it's what I've been surprised by is how much they've struggled on defense. I mean, they still have really good players, including Derek Stingley, maybe the best corner in America.
The 3rd down and 5 here for Kellen Mond. 2 touchdowns on the day, pressure coming, blitz is picked up, the pass, one-handed catch, Weidermeyer stabbed it. And that was a bullet from the quarterback, and Weidermeyer with a beautiful grab.
Well, let's take a better look at that from the AT&T Skycam. Someone check his gloves. Is there some Velcro on those gloves? My goodness. I mean, that ball's thrown hard, too, over the middle. And he just snags it with one hand. I'm telling you, man, that is awesome right there from Weidermeyer.
They go right back to the ground game after that pass play, and it looked like Spiller, the running back, got tripped up. Gain of 1 or 2. Look, check in with Holly.
Well, guys, this might be some good news for Texas A&M. I was just checking on Bobby Brown III. I saw him with that right knee injury when he celebrated, and I just saw a guy in the crowd ask him, "Are you okay?" He gave him the thumbs up. He's getting on the bike right now to work it out. He is putting weight on that foot and moving around, so let's see if he can return.
And that would be great after what happened there. Unfortunate injury during the celebration.
Inside a minute to go in the quarter. Here's Mond on second down. And Chapman pulls it in, spun down, 2 yards short of the line to gain. What a day for Caleb Chapman. 5 catches coming in. 7 catches today on 10 targets.
It's been really reliable. It's a big target. Caleb Mond's been accurate when trying to go after him. If I'm Texas A&M right here, third and short, plus territory, I might go heavy, heavy play action. Heavy, heavy play action, see if I can't steal one down the field. And then come back and maybe go for it on fourth down.
Instead, they run it. Spiller trying to find a hole. Able to get the first down. He runs hard. There are 3 or 4. D lineman right there, and Spiller packs a punch himself at 225. Didn't care. Just fought through it. So we go to the fourth in Bryan College Station, Kyle Field, A&M without a top 5 win under Jimbo Fisher. Can they finally get it? They're down 4-4 as we go to the fourth. Back to the SEC on ESPN. Florida leading Texas A&M 28-24 behind terrific quarterback play. Kyle Trask for the Gators and Kellen Mond for the Aggies, but it was the rushing attack of Texas A&M that got it back in the game. 97 yards on the ground on 14 attempts in the third quarter alone.
Yeah, really committing to that offensive line and that run game as Isaiah Spiller has really started to put together a heck of a performance, taking advantage of a Florida defense that's had a difficult time of being gap sound. It hasn't done a great job of tackling in space. So let's see if the Aggies continue to lean on that run game here in the fourth quarter.
Instead, it's play action for Mond, looking downfield, single coverage. A flag is thrown, the ball thrown out of the end zone, going for Chapman, defended by Marco Wilson.
Kellen Mond had a little adrenaline on that throw.
You think?
He was. I'm telling you, he thought to think about that one in the break. Probably told him, hey, we're going to come back with a shot play. You good with that? He got all fired up and threw it about 12 yards out of the back of the end zone.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, if that's interference, is that considered a catchable pass?
Could be holding, too.
Holding. Defense number 3. The 10-yard penalty. Carries an automatic first down.
So that means that occurred before the ball was thrown.
So you see Todd Grantham trying to get this defense going a little bit. Ramped up some of the pressure packages, the blitz packages. That's something he's known for. He's a very aggressive, universally respected defensive coordinator because of the pressure he puts on the quarterback. Well, what neutralizes pressure sometimes is a really sound and dominant rushing attack. So see what Grantham tries to attack him with on first and 10.
With both Spiller and Smith in the game, here's Mond keeping it inside the 25. And Mond hit hard at the 20-yard line by Elam. A good pickup there on first down. Well, on Monday night, we have a doubleheader for you. Who will be the quarterback for the Patriots? Bill Belichick saying, we're taking it hour by hour. They play the Broncos, then it's the Chargers and Saints. Our coverage starts at 3 o'clock Eastern time with Monday Night Countdown.
I guess I'm canceling my plans for Monday. My goodness. I can't wait for that doubleheader. How about Justin Herbert, too, with the L.A. Chargers? Now the starting quarterback, Anthony Lynn, making that decision. The rookie from Oregon looking excellent early on.
Second and 4, Mond again. That was well defended by Florida. Mond is squashed by 3 Gators at the 20. Third down.
You got to think here, Texas A&M, the way you're running the football, is it 4 down territory? Right now, you're looking at about 3rd and 3 and running the ball really efficiently. You got some Florida Gators defenders with hands on the hips. Do you challenge that offensive line yet again and say, hey, you guys got 2 downs to get it here? A 3rd and short.
Such a big game for Texas A&M. The Aggie fans getting a little anxious. 9-4 2 years ago, Jimbo's first year, 8-5 last year. Still no wins over a top 5 team, but a chance to pick it up. Can they get a first down? Nope. Maybe they go on fourth down. Let's see. They picked up about a yard. Offense still on the field. They're going.
I'd go for it. Offensive line's been playing well.
Again, to beat a top five team, I mean, at some point, you got to make a play. At some point, you got to do something special, and maybe it's here. I mean, plenty of time if you kick the field goal, cut it to a one-point game, but Jimbo wants more right now. They got the fullback, Kagan Baldry, in here. With Spiller on fourth and two. Spiller cuts it back. Has a first down and more. He's got a touchdown and the lead for A&M. That would qualify as special. Rushing yards and two touchdowns for Isaiah Spiller.
Don't ever run on field. Don't ever.
Looked like Jimbo was saying don't ever run on the field to one of the guys on the sideline there. You don't want to get a penalty. Extra point makes it 31-28. Texas A&M has the lead over number four. The first lead for Texas A&M since the Vanderbilt game week one, 31-28 over Florida.
Let's take a look at that touchdown from the AT&T 5G Skycam. I just love this little wrap concept. It's a little bend concept. See Spiller on fourth and short trying to run to the right side of the offensive line, and then he follows those reversers back around to the left to create some leverage there on the edges of the defense. That's a really nice design, especially taking advantage of the aggressiveness by Florida's defense, understanding the down and distance. Spiller's been outstanding in the second half.
First real adversity that Kyle Trask has faced in 2020. And when you're facing some adversity, go to the best player. Kyle Pitts, first catch since the first quarter, and a gain of nine.
It's automatic, right? I mean, hey, things aren't really going well. Let's get this offense back into a rhythm. Where's 84? Oh, there he is. I'm going to throw it to him. Good job.
It was like you and Julio back in the day, right? Just throw it to Julio. In
trouble. Absolutely.
Need a big play. Out of the backfield. Can he break a tackle? Yes. There goes Naquan Wright into A&M territory. Oh, my goodness. Did he drill the defensive back O'Neal on that play? But man, you could see that after the catch, if he broke a tackle, he was going to pick up another 20 yards. He got 28 in all.
Yeah, just a great job here as he's got his running back right working in one-on-one against Buddy Johnson. Buddy Johnson misses the tackle, and I love how Wright finishes that run. Not the biggest guy on the roster at the running back spot, only 195 pounds, but man, he packs a punch.
Just like that, they're at the 41. Play fake for Trask with a ton of time. Overthrows Pitts as there was pressure in his face, but Pitts still caught it. Leal was right in the face of Trask, so he threw high, but Pitts, with those incredible hands, pulled it in, and it's a first down.
Most guys, it's an incompletion, maybe even a pick, because it's tipped up in the air and a defender gets it. Pitts. He reaches out, fully extends, and you see that massive catch radius and the athleticism, too. To focus, get the catch, maintain your momentum, and burst forward for a few yards after catch.
First down on the 30-yard line. Wright stays in the game at running back. And it's play action. Trask in trouble. Looking for Pitts' triple cover. Now Trask throws for Pitts, but it's incomplete. Well, there have been some excellent tight ends recently. A lot of first-round draft picks the last 5-6 years at the tight end position. I don't know that I've seen a better one, though, than Pitts.
I think he's the toughest matchup in college football. I really believe that. What do you cover him with? He's 6'6". He runs 4.5 40. He's excellent, excellent with his route running and the way he can stretch the field vertically. And with how he's improved as a blocker, you can keep him in line and create better matchups for him. I just don't know who you cover him with.
Second and 10. Wright reversing. Inside the 25-yard line, bringing up a third down. I mean, you say toughest matchup in college football, and I'm wondering if there's a better pass catcher, regardless of position.
I mean, gosh, you'd be hard-pressed to find There's so many good receivers, but I'm trying really hard not to be a prisoner of the moment because I've now seen Kyle Pitts twice and he's put on a show both occasions. So I'm trying hard not to be a prisoner of the moment, but he'd be at or near the top of every list if I had to pick a guy to rely on. Here he is, single covered way wide.
Not a true freshman. See if they go that way on third and five. That's where the ball's going. Pitts against the true freshman. While he's on the ground, did he make the catch? No, incomplete, but man, I thought he caught it. Incomplete. It's fourth down and five. I'd love to see that again because just live, it was awfully close. He slipped and still almost caught the ball.
And so close. Do his hands get underneath it? Ah! Oh!
I mean, it can move if you control it.
Does it touch the ground?
But even if it does, Greg, if you've got control, it can touch the ground. Does he have control, though?
See, right there, it does look like the bottom of the ball does, in fact, hit the ground. But, man, it was closer than I initially thought.
So a field goal try to tie the game for McPherson. Play clock is down to one. They don't have to burn their last timeout. It's going to be a delay of game. He missed it, but it won't matter because it's a delay of game penalty.
Delay of game. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Fourth down.
Maybe Dan Mullen didn't want to use that last timeout. McPherson has the leg. I mean, he's made a 55-yarder this year. But he just missed on that one, although everything was disrupted.
The game clock to 9 minutes, 59 seconds.
It's got to be disruptive for the kicker. You see the flag. You know what the clock's at. You're waiting for the snap. You hear the whistle.
Yeah, he's an excellent kicker. Shouldn't be too affected by what just transpired.
48-yard try to tie it. Now Florida moves. Now it's Florida falling apart with mental errors.
Ball start, 74 offense, 5-yard penalty, remains fourth down.
That's Will Harrod, who's in there really only on field goal tries. So now it's a 53-yard attempt. I mentioned he made a 55-yarder earlier this year. Now what? Timeout, Texas A&M. I'm just looking. Okay, they have 11 guys on the field. A little curious why he called a timeout there. So each team with one timeout in a close game, will that be a factor? Dave Pass, Greg McElroy, Holly Rowe at Texas A&M. Florida, after back-to-back five-yard penalties, will try a 53-yarder to tie the game. Evan McPherson, the all-time leader in field goal percentage at Florida. Made a 55-yarder earlier in the season. Missed only four field goals the last 3 years. Wow, he absolutely crushed that thing. Oh, my goodness.
Oh my goodness.
That would have been good. We say this a lot in exaggeration. That was good from at least 63, maybe longer.
Maybe eight, more like 85. I mean, that ball had a rocket behind it. Beautifully done by McPherson as he ties the game here in College Station.
Yeah, Oklahoma, two losses on the year. How about Virginia Tech? What a comeback. That's a team to watch maybe in the ACC.
I'll tell you what, the ACC most improved without question as far as conferences are concerned.
A&M goes back to the ground game. Another punishing run by Spiller out to the 31 for five. Two terrific quarterbacks here. We'll also see two tonight on ABC. De'Ara King in Miami, ranked number 7, taking on Trevor Lawrence. And number 1, Clemson, 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific on ABC and the ESPN app. What do you think of that ball game?
I think it's going to be a heck of a matchup. De'Ara King and that offense there for Miami, the tempo they play with, so fun to watch. Clemson really hasn't had to do a whole lot just yet. I have a feeling their best might come out tonight.
Another run play on second down, this time nowhere to go for Spiller. We have not seen many plays go for zero or negative yards on the ground for A&M in the second half. It's a big third down here. See how Todd Grantham handles this from a defensive coordinator standpoint, third and four.
This is kind of a tough spot too for Kellen Mond. I mean, he hasn't thrown a pass, it feels like, in forever, especially in a critical down and distance. They've been so in rhythm with the run game. So first throwing a little bit, let's see if he's on the mark.
Eight attempts in the second half after 22 in the first. They're in the midway point here of the fourth quarter. Florida rushing five. And open comes Smith for a first down, and he lost the ball. It's picked up by Florida. Will they rule Smith down? Marco Wilson with a fumble recovery. There's also an injured Gator. The officials haven't made a ruling yet. Can't see the number on the injured Florida player. Officials still conferring. We'll come back and sort it out.
The ruling on the field is a completed catch with a fumble recovered by the defense. First down.
Ruling on the field is a turnover, and looking at the replay, it appears they got it right. Jeremiah Moon, first of all, hit his own guy, Brad Stewart, who went to the locker room. But more pressing is the fumble by Anias Smith here. Look at the clean hit and rip by Moon to force a turnover at the 37 of A&M.
Great job by Moon, hustling, retracing, and dislodging the football. That was the play Florida's defense needed, because A&M had an awful lot of momentum here in the second half.
First turnover by either team, and after that last McPherson field goal, Florida's already in field goal range. Gators will run it. Oh, what a hit. Pierce got smacked by Johnson. A loss on the play.
Well, guys, the Florida defense had been wilting a little bit over here, but that turnover has energized this Gator sideline. Darrell Slayton just came over, was yelling at his guys, listen, if we just stop the run, we're right back in this ball game. They've got some energy now. We'll see if that can help them finish out stronger here in the fourth quarter.
Great job, Holly, because the time of possession was so in favor of A&M here in the second half that they really needed to get off the field right there. The turnover did just that.
Trask, three touchdown passes today. He finds Tony over the middle. First down for Tony at the 25. And finally down to the 22. Gain of 16 and a first down for the Gators midway through the fourth in a tie ball game between ranked teams here at Kyle Field.
And I love taking advantage of the matchup here. You got Kadarius Toney on the left working against a linebacker on a little bit of a juke route. See him move a little bit, a little shimmy. Kadarius Toney in the open field working against Buddy Johnson. That's advantage Gators. That's a great job by the offensive coordinator Brian Johnson finding a matchup that they can take advantage of.
Play fake, Trask looking, throws. Toney is wide open. Dribble out of bounds at the 1 yard line by Richardson. Looked like a pick play downfield that freed up Toney, and it is first and goal for Florida.
And this was a nice job here by Toney. Very patient, working across the field. Nobody really there to account for big number one. He almost scores with it.
Pierce, the running back, on first and goal. Trask keeping it, trying to stretch the ball out. He did not get in. Trask talking to the official, saying he stretched it out initially before contact, but they did not give it to him. Second and goal. Trask throws to Pierce, and Pierce breaks a tackle and scores. Touchdown, Florida. The Gators are back in front. Kyle Trask with his parents, who are both Texas A&M grads, grew up about an hour and a half from here in Manville, Texas, named after Kyle Field. He's getting his name into the Heisman race. Four touchdown passes today, 14 on the year. ...38-31 Florida. And we'll be back in 10 seconds. So Kyle Trask grew up an Aggie fan. Family, all Texas A&M fans, but not really recruited coming out of high school. Florida wasn't even sure what they had, and he's had another brilliant effort here today, taking advantage of the A&M giveaway to take the lead back.
Yeah, he's been awesome, just awesome with how he's played and bounced back. And man, the poise and just the composure. Never sweating as A&M seized momentum in the game, never sweating, allowing his defense to make a play for him, and boom, he takes it right down the field with some very accurate throws and leads Florida to the go-ahead score. Really impressive stuff from Kyle Trask yet again today.
And now the senior Kellen Mond in his 37th start as an Aggie, the pressure on his shoulders. It'll be a touchback. Mond will start from his 25. Here's Laura.
All right.
Scoring games. 6:14 left here. Remember, only one timeout for A&M. Kellen Mond on his 25-yard line. Gonna hand it off. Spiller breaks a tackle at the 30, but stumbles. Still got 7 yards on the play. Time for today's weekend wake up, brought to you by Wendy's Breakfast. We've got Tennessee, Georgia up next on ABC, Iowa State, Texas Tech, Bama at Ole Miss tonight on ESPN, and our ABC prime game, number 7 Miami and top ranked Clemson.
A heck of a slate. As the noon window wraps up, I mean, we're off to the races. Got to go find about 100 TVs because we got a lot of games to watch, Dave.
On second and three, Mond facing pressure and reaching out to make the catch is Weidermann and getting a first down to the 36-yard line.
Kellen Mond is hanging in there, man, because Todd Grantham starting to dial up a couple pressures. And he just takes a hit right here from an unblocked defender and still throws it very accurately while keeping his eyes downfield. Got to appreciate the growth that Kellen Mond showed today. Probably his best game ever against a top five ranked team.
Mond to the air again. In traffic, catch made by Chapman at the 49 for a first down. That was an excellent throw. Plenty of time here for A&M, and plus that Florida defense got to be tired as often as it's been on the field here in the second half.
Beautiful throw there, Kellen Mond. My goodness, pinpoint accuracy between several defenders.
Play action here for Mond, moving to his right, looking deep, got a receiver. It's caught! Chapman, touchdown! Chapman shaking off on a ball that looked like it might get intercepted, but Chapman ripped it away from the defender. 51 yards. And how about Kellen Mond, third touchdown pass today? Two of them have been to Chapman, who's still down.
All right, this is really nicely done here. You're going to see Chapman, who goes over the top, but watch the safety really bite on this over route. See the safety, he'll stay down, which allows Chapman over the top and one-on-one. Ball's a little late and underthrown, but Chapman does a great job going up and making the play. We talked about it at the beginning of the game. The biggest thing for Kellen Mond is he's got to hit those big plays down the field. If they're going to be successful and this offense is going to hit its stride, it's got to be down the field. He's got to connect on those. He's done so several times today, and another beautiful throw there to Chapman, who goes up and makes an excellent play.
Sophomore from Friendswood, Texas, who missed all of last year, or excuse me, missed all of 2018 with a knee injury. Hopefully he's okay. Chance to tie the game here. 4.5 to go. It got tipped and it still went through to tie the game at 38. Seth Small's kick deflected but ends up crossing over the crossbar to tie it at 38. You could hear it too.
Let's take a look. One of those. It wasn't pretty, but we look good. That's the way, that's what the coaches are saying there. You don't have to draw a picture on the scorecard. But that one real close there as Florida almost made a game-changing play on extra point block.
All right, Saturday's here. Time to represent your school. Show us how big you're going to be today. Submit your best fan video this weekend to hashtag ShowYourSaturday, and you just might get your 15 seconds of fan fame. Kellen Mond, in one of the biggest games of his career, trying to get the first win for the program against the top five team since Jimbo Fisher took over in 2018. And boy, he's been terrific. 322 yards, three touchdowns. The ensuing kickoff ends up in the end zone for a touchback. And now it's Kyle Trask's turn with 4.5 to go and one timeout.
Well, guys, you could expect a heavy dose of Kyle Pitts and Kyle Trask here on this drive, but the one problem is Kyle Pitts is not 100%. I saw him take off his shoe, kind of examine his left foot, and his last time out on the field, he was clearly limping. Let's see if he's able to overcome it here on this critical drive in the fourth.
Yeah, again, those numbers came primarily in the first quarter. He was working on that left foot for a while there before putting that shoe back on. Trask on first down, wide open out of the backfield is Davis, a mistake defensively by A&M. And Davis in one play takes the ball all the way to the 48-yard line for a 23-yard pickup.
Yeah, Davis has been outstanding in the passing game, and most of it, though, as a result of A&M just not being able to get out to the flats. They have hit that play a few different times, and Davis is so capable in the open field. Love that drive starting play there from the offensive coordinator Brian Johnson, trying to get his quarterback back in a rhythm, regain some momentum on our side of the football.
Play fake, Trask looking, now fires, knocked away from Copeland, the true freshman Jalen Jones, who gave up a couple of touchdowns last week against Alabama, but is a promising young player from here in the state of Texas, makes a nice play, second and 10.
It's gonna be a good one, that's for sure. Jalen Jones got great length, 6'2", so he's gonna match up against some of those longer and taller wide receivers that he'll see throughout the SEC. That play right there is really tight coverage. Fortunate for Trask, they were only able to get one hand on the football, because that could have very easily been intercepted.
Florida number 4 was number 3 last week, but switched places with Georgia. Gators trying to get to 3-0. They'll run it here on 2nd and 10. Davis cuts back, but he's thrown down and fumbled the ball, and it's picked up by Leal. Buddy Johnson forced the fumble. Leal gives A&M its first takeaway of the game. Texas A&M will have it in Florida territory. The kind of plays you have to make to beat a top five team, and A&M is doing that here in the second half. This is what Jimbo Fisher told us. He kept pointing out, we got to hit on the long pass plays. We've got to break tackles when we run the ball. We've got to create turnovers. We can't beat Florida if we don't do those things. They've done all of those things here in the fourth.
They have. They made the play, too. I mean, it's a great job by Buddy Johnson. Man, you got a feel for Malik Davis. He's had such a nice game today. Let's get a little loose with that football in the left arm, and it just slips out. And the awaiting Leal grabs it. Huge play from the Aggie defense.
They'll go with Spiller. And trying to keep the feet moving. Run down at the 46. So good job defensively up front by Florida. Amari Burney, linebacker, coming in there to make the stick. And a gain of 2 yards on first down. And one timeout left for each team during 3 minutes to go here in regulation.
You still got your entire offense here if you're Texas A&M. Nothing you need to think about as far as running the football, controlling the clock. Just call your best available play. put it in the hands of the guys you trust.
Here's a pitch to Spiller out in space. Hurdles a defender. Helmet goes flying. Close to a first down is the running back, Spiller. Trevez Johnson lost his lid. Will have to leave for a play. It's going to be third down and short. A&M trying to get right over the ball and snap it. Quarterback sneak from Mond. Appears to have a first down.
So much of Texas A&M's run game debate today has been north and south. I mean, only a couple different occasions where they've really tried to secure the edge and get their backs on the perimeter. Really liked that play call a second ago as they pitched it to Spiller on the sweep. Kind of changed the launch point where the defenders have been traditionally chasing the ball these first three and a half quarters.
Second time already this year, Florida's defense has given up over 500 yards of offense. Spiller has 161 on the ground and two touchdowns. We'll see if they give it to him here to try to milk some clock. Yep, straight ahead, inside the 35. Down to the 33, four more yards. Clock continues to run. They're in field goal range. Seth Small's career long is 52. It would be about a 50-yarder from here.
They get into a similar action that they just ran with the jet sweep working from left to right, and they actually had Weidermeyer working from right to left. They might be able to get Weidermeyer right out into the flat because he was wide open right there. So they might try to catch Florida off guard, maybe a little misdirection boot if the opportunity presents itself.
Here's Spiller again, and wow, what a play backside. The guy that lost his helmet earlier, Trevez Johnson, showing incredible speed there, a tackle for a loss. Back at the 35-yard line, bringing up third down and long.
Man, this is great job. Number 16 on the little nickel blitz off the right-hand side. And just chasing it down. That's a lead speed right there to make a play and force a third and long. Be interesting here to see what Jimbo decides to do. I think you got to throw it.
53-yard field goal attempt or so from here. Approaching a minute to go. Third down and eight. Mond will throw, and it's caught over the middle for a first down and more inside the 20. Chase Lane gets the first down and more. And the Aggies in business here late at home against number four. They can take it down. They reset the chains. They started the clock. They do have a timeout. Where does your kicker want it?
Right here, I'm Texas A&M. I'm thinking I'd run it a couple times, try to center it on third down and kick it on fourth.
We'll give it to Spiller, and he cuts it back inside the 15 and brought down inside the 10. So the clock will stop here to get rid of the chains on first and goal.
This is also a spot, too. If you're Kellen Mond, talk to your guys. You don't want to score a touchdown here and give them a chance potentially back. So wind it all the way down, depending on what happens. Looks like it's going to happen. You don't want to score a touchdown, though. You want to kick it with no time remaining.
Agreed.
Yeah, don't give Florida even a second to work with. And that's what Jimbo will do here. We'll call a timeout. 2 seconds to go. Jimbo Fisher, perhaps on the verge of his first win against a top five team since he took over the A&M program, and his senior quarterback, Kellen Mond, along with sophomore running back Isaiah Spiller, were the difference makers offensively in the second half. Remember, they got down. It was 28-17. They made all kinds of mental errors, bad penalties, but they overcame those. And now 2 seconds away from victory.
Tremendous resilience. I mean, they've hung in there. The offensive line answered the challenge. Kellen Mond was so good throughout the course of this game. He's been criticized, has been questioned, and he delivered one of the best performances of his career. I mean, bar none. So clutch, so efficient, so in control.
Yep.
To give his team a chance. Congratulations to that young man for giving them a chance. And now just a short field goal away from a massive win for Jimbo Fisher in this Aggie program.
That's why the Gatorade's out. First things first, 20
56-yard try for Seth Small to win the game for Texas A&M. Nervous Aggie fans can take a breath. Jimbo Fisher has done it. Beat a top five team. And hands Florida its first loss of the season. First top five home win in 18 years for Texas A&M as a program.
Because you got to learn to win these. You got to learn to not play the scoreboard and play every play. Relentless competitor, win your space. The scoreboard takes care of itself. And I can't say enough. People doubt them, and we ain't done. We deserve some of it. But we had a very good football team and a heck of a program.
You speak about doubt. There was a moment where things were unraveling for your group with penalties and dumb mistakes. How did they get it back together and finish so well?
Coach did a good job. Weren't unraveling, just having impatience. You can't be impatient. You got to play this game, though. You can't cheat the game. The game makes you play it, and we played it today.
Kellen Mond has taken his fair share of criticism. How do you describe that young man's performance?
And I'm going to tell you, he's had some mistakes. Every quarterback does. Let me tell you something. He's the reason we're winning football games, and there's a lot of these guys. It's been awesome, man. It's been awesome.
Coach, your defense had to get some crucial stops against a very high-powered offense. How important was that for your defense?
Critical. Listen, they bend, they gave a lot of plays up, but they got that turnover when they had to.
Coach said that's your game, baby. How hard was it to earn this moment, a top five win for you today, Kellen? I've never seen you play better.
It was big time. But, you know, we had our ups and downs this game, but I just told everyone to keep their composure and continue to fight. And the defense was, you know, able to come up with a big time stop to give us the ball back. So. I mean, it's a full team win playing full four quarters.
You were so accurate today. You made big throws, none bigger than to Chapman there in that fourth quarter. How were you so accurate today?
It just goes back to practice and the way I train. You know, I'm very hard on myself in the way that I prepare myself. And, you know, my guys push me, my coaches push me, and we're able to come out and have a big win.
Kellen, how great was this win? Listen to the crowd and enjoy it as you walk off. Thank you.
Thank you.
And let's take a look at today's More Driven Moment, brought to you by Goodyear. The takeaway by the Aggie defense, Buddy Johnson forcing the fumble. Malik Davis coughing it up here. Big hit by Johnson, the senior from Dallas. And then the short field goal after A&M moved it down the field, and the Gatorade bath for Jimbo's first win against a top five team here at A&M. What a performance by Kellen Mond, a guy making his 37th start, plays one of the best games of his career. College football scoreboard is coming up next, then it's Arkansas and Auburn. For Holly Rowe, Greg McElroy, our entire crew, I'm Dave Pasch. So long from Texas A&M, where the Aggies take down number 4.